In a year of long-awaited releases finally seeing the light of day, no movie has been awaited longer than Zack Snyder's Justice League. And for those who have been waiting almost half a decade to see this near-mythical film, the good news is there's not that much longer to go. I'm Terry Schwartz, this is IGN FanFest, and I am so thrilled to be here for an interview with director Zack Snyder himself to give us the full story on how the Snyder Cut went from being an unfinished print he showed his friends at his house to the four-hour movie being released on HBO Max on March 18th. We put the call out for your questions and you more than delivered. So buckle up, Zach, because we have a lot of fan questions to go through today. Welcome.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it. I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, we're excited to chat with you. And again, there's like, this movie has had such an interesting journey. How close is the Snyder Cut that you're close to releasing now to the original version that you were editing? And or how much has it evolved with time, distance, and fan feedback?
You know, the amazing thing about the fan feedback was we want you to just do it exactly as you intended. So that, and that's always empowering and exciting. So, And how close is it to the like original version, the version that I worked on? It's essentially the same movie. That was the director's cut that I had completed. And David Brenner and I, who was the editor, we sat down and watched this and we said, wow, 4 hours. This is insane. This is awesome. And actually, you know, we always talk about that was a cut down from, it was even a longer version. We just did some tightening and some more, you know, we put the screws to it a little bit more to get it to the close to 4 hours. So it's got a bit longer in the editorial process that we've just gone through. But really that was just a function of some of the visual effects being padded out and, looking at the scenes one more time. And there's a couple other angles that we liked, you know, but essentially it's the same film.
Now, it's not, shall we say, traditional for a 4 hour long movie to be released. And I remember you had said at the time when you were first working on Justice League, the studio mandate note was to cut it down to 2 hours, I believe, is the feedback.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they wanted it to be exactly 2 hours. I remember going, Batman v Superman, especially the Ultimate Edition, is just about 3 hours. Even the theatrical release is, I think, 2 hours and 25 minutes, something like that. And I said, but now there's 6 characters, so how, in what world, okay, sure.
I am curious, though, in your conversations with Warner Brothers, what has changed, do you think, that has caused them to greenlight actually releasing the even longer version than what you had originally put together as your director's cut?
Yeah, I think, I think that there's a combination of things that all sort of came together in a perfect storm that allowed this to become reality. Probably the most important is the amazing fan support for the film and the near legendary movement that arose from these amazing fans that just wanted to see the movie the way I thought it should be seen. And, it was that groundswell that really catapulted it into, got the attention of, I think, HBO Max and the Warner execs, and they felt like maybe this could be cool.
Well, we have our first question, again, first of many from the fans. This one is from XXP60 on Twitter. They're wondering, are you fully satisfied in how Zack Snyder's Justice League turned out? Or would you have added anything else but couldn't because of time, actors' availability, etc.?
No, I'm very satisfied. I couldn't imagine it, coming out as completely as it has. You know, we were able even to fill in a couple of the impossible gaps that I thought were never going to see the light of day, that I had always hoped to fill in. But, now, having been given this kind of this ability to finish it the way I want, you really get to see the whole thing.
And we finally will get to see it on March 18th. It's so close. It is a full film. It's being released in its entirety. But I did want to ask, at DC Fandom, you'd originally mentioned that you were considering releasing it in 4 one-hour installments. And I was wondering if you could share what changed in between discussing that and then deciding to release it as the full film.
There was a couple things. I mean, it was always to be completed as one theatrical release. We'd always, because that's the way I originally, you know, it was made as a 4-hour film. Now, remember, the film is chaptered anyway. It's like, you know, part one, it, you know, don't count on it, Batman, you know, and then about 40 minutes later, I forget exactly, you know, part two, it, you know, the Age of Heroes, and then on and on, you know. And so that was the way the film was created, just in my mind, as the way it was easily digestible. There was so much, and I just felt like this kind of, you know, chapters as you went forward was really the best way to kind of absorb it. So it was always going to be finished as a single film, but then, you know, I thought, oh, it might be fun to break it up. But, you know, that just got complicated, and everyone started to get nervous about, like, whether or not, you know, it was contractually this or that. And I said, you know what, it's fine. Like, the hours, the 4 hours, you know, it's a great way to watch the movie. And it's easy to pause and go get your, go hit the potty or pick up some popcorn or whatever you got to do.
Yeah.
Cause you know,
don't make the people wait any longer.
Yeah. So, yeah, exactly. I think they would have been mad if they had to wait like weeks.
Right. Go the weekly episodic route. Now, you, I'm sure you assumed that I would ask you this, so I figured I'd get it out of the way at the top. But do you have a finished running time? Can you tell us how long the movie actually will be? More than 214 minutes, you said.
Oh, no, it's a little over 4 hours. I think it's like 4 hours and a few minutes, you know, with the titles.
Is that locked, too? Because I think the last time you spoke about it, you were still editing it and you weren't sure.
100% locked. No. Yeah, just it's 100% done.
Amazing.
Now, come over again, and watch another fan. I got to write my theater.
All right, I'm hanging up. I'm leaving. That's it. Sorry, we're cutting it short. I'm coming over. I'll take that. Take you up on that. We'll talk after. We do have another question. This one is from Sarwar Jawani on Twitter.
Hey Zach, my question for you is: when you found out that you were going to be able to release your cut of Justice League, what scene of yours are you looking forward to us seeing for the first time?
I guess Cyborg's backstory really, to me, is, you know, such an important part of the movie. And it's so, his whole arc and journey is so important. And there were just some really cool stuff that we shot and that we created that I was really excited for fans to see.
Yeah, you've talked about how Ray Fisher's character is the heart of your movie, and we definitely haven't been able to see that. And we'll talk about him a little bit more in a bit, but actually,
sure.
That's a perfect transition because you brought us a little treat. Do you want to set up what you brought along to show everyone?
Oh, yeah. We created this really cool, at first when I was doing some exploratory with Garson at U&Co, I was like, I really want to do a cool kind of, I wasn't sure how we were going to use it. We had talked about maybe it was a title sequence. We had talked about maybe it was a, like, because we had talked in marketing about, like, oh, maybe we're going to do like a sort of a week of character appreciation, you know, like we're really do a deep dive into each character, each member of the Justice League, and like, let's really explore them. So it was talked about in that way. And then we just kind of, we all started like doodling, and it became this kind of fine art piece of its own that really kind of talks about the mother boxes and the characters' origins, and just the really kind of what I find it really beautiful and immersive, and yeah, it's super fun.
Let's take a look.
The smart money's on Harlem, and the moon is in the street, and the shadow boys are breaking all the laws. And you're east of East St. Louis, and the wind is making speeches, and the rain sounds like a round of applause. essays in the mirror. And the band is going home. It's raining hammers, it's raining nails. It's true, there's nothing left for him down here. Oh, it's time, time, time. It's time, time, time. And it's time. It's time, time, time that you love. And it's time, time, time.
I feel like I should, like, we need like applause or something in the background, because anytime we hear Tom Waits perform like that.
Yeah, Tom Waits.
I did want to ask. Yeah, yeah, you use Tom Waits' Time is the song being played. You are always so specific with your music choice. Tell us why this was the right song.
This Tom Waits song, you know, we loved it on the piece. It really was perfect, and it was in the style and sort of mood of my Justice League film, and I thought it was like a perfect song. And Tom, you know, famously doesn't do this sort of thing, but we showed it to him and he was like, yeah, I'll do that. You guys can have it for that. So
just call up Tom Waits. Clearly, there's clear inspiration drawn from like classical sculptures and reliefs of the old gods, maybe.
Oh yeah, I did I doodled like all those. There's a million Easter eggs in it, and if you go look, there's storylines that you know, that I had been working on that would have been if the film had been continued, or if you look at the past histories, there's a bunch of little details in there for everybody. So it's really worth taking a long, slow look at, because it's really fun. And I think, you know, for fans, it's really a treat. And yeah, there's tons of, I'm not going to say, because I feel like it's important for everyone to kind of, you know, take it apart and analyze it and say like, oh, look, I see this and I see that. And then we can talk about it more.
Awesome. Well, that's a challenge if I've ever heard one, and people can watch and rewatch that for sure. I thought that was a perfect way though to transition to talking about our returning heroes, our Justice League that you are getting to show us again and show us that much more of. I did want to ask, you know, obviously since you introduced characters like Cyborg, The Flash, Aquaman, of course. Like, Aquaman had his own movie. There's been another Wonder Woman movie that has been released. And I'm curious if any of your new editing creative decisions have been informed by the DC films that have come out since your Justice League, or if you've evolved in your depiction of the characters at all.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting point of view. The answer is no. This film was finished before those films were probably even shot. And so I kind of stayed the course with my point of view. I think you can sort of view my Snyderverse version of the DC superhero canon as its kind of own thing. I love Patty and James and what they've done with their movies, and they're amazing. But at this point, I was just like, you know, this is kind of its own thing, and it doesn't really owe anything to anything. So I'm just going to do it exactly as I had always intended.
Now, we do, of course, we got a bunch of questions in finding out some of the backstory and deeper lore about some of these characters. So this one is from Sam Sievers on Twitter, and it is about Batman.
Hey, Zach. So I grew up with Tim Burton's Batman, and that version of the character has a body count that could almost rival Rambo's. So the idea of a live-action Batman killing people is just sort of baked in at this point. Almost every version does it. But I was curious if your Batman started with a no-kill policy 20 years ago, and during his downward spiral, he just lost it at some point, and could Superman's sacrifice inspire him to stop killing once again?
Listen, probably our Bruce had a higher moral or stronger moral compass when he first started crime fighting in Gotham 20 years ago. But, you know, there's been a lot of, he's seen a lot of, you know, rough stuff happen over the years. And I think that he, you know, he's a bit jaded now. I mean, obviously. And, you know, the death of Robin and others, you know, I think that he now has found himself in a dark place. But yes, the whole point was that the death of Superman really shakes him out of that and puts him on this really, you know, sort of cathartic path to like form the Justice League and kind of do his part. You know, because like if you think about it, the Justice League is made up of entirely of like almost godlike characters with these godlike powers. And he's just a guy, you know. I mean, yes, he is the world's greatest detective and he is this, you know, incredible force. He's, you know, as far as humanity goes, but in the end, he is just a guy. So it's like his job of bringing them together is kind of, but it was also one of the most important jobs because there would be no Justice League without Bruce.
So next we have a special question. This is from Hamad from Qatar. He's been actually a longtime supporter and major donor of the American Foundation of Suicide Prevention over the years, awesome. And has been very passionate in the Release the Snyder Cut movement. So let's check out Hamad's question.
Hi, Zach. What did it feel like to see Ben Affleck put on the cowl again?
Yeah, so we did a couple, we did a little bit of additional photography for this film. And we brought a few of the cast members back just for this little scene I wanted to grab. I was slightly nostalgic and a little bit, you know, like, I don't want to say weepy, that sounds a little bit extreme, but it certainly was quite a thing to behold.
So we have another question. I'm going to set this one up a little bit because I heard you speak about putting Superman in the black and silver suit that I believe, and I'm paraphrasing you, so please correct me, you actually shot that in the regular Superman suit but color corrected it later. Is that the case with how you created that?
Yeah, my visual effects supervisor and I, DJ and I, I had long conversations with the studio about the black suit. I was a big advocate. They were not so much. And we would go back and forth. And I said, okay, what about, let me just at least do some tests to see if I could, you know, put him in the black suit and what it would look like. And so we devised a method in which we could easily turn the suit using the existing suit to the black and silver suit that you see in the movie. And so we knew exactly how to do it when we went into it. And as I say, it was always my intention to have him in that.
And we've had a chance to see it too. So with that context, this question from Frederick Lopez is about your experience getting to see that suit. So let's pull that up.
My question is for Zack Snyder. What was it like seeing Superman in the black and silver suit for the first time? I cannot wait to finally see the Snyder Cut on March 18th.
It was cool. Yeah, I got to admit, you know, even we, you know, because the first thing we did was a quick test, you know, to make sure that we had all our ducks in a row. And just seeing it, you know, we all just sat back like, wow, are we really doing this? This is amazing. And so, yeah, it was really cool. And I mean, the other cool thing is, of course, you know, we saw a version of it in the Zod flashback in Man of Steel, you know, because, you know, he's sort of in it in the Zod nightmare sequence where Zod's confronting him and trying to get him to basically join the dark side at that point.
So we have another special question from Joanna from Ecuador, another big member of the Release the Snyder Cut movement. She wants to know a little bit about some of the female hero or heroes in the movie. So let's take a look at this question.
Lovely.
From Joanna from Ecuador.
I'm Joanna from Guayaquil, Ecuador, and this is my question. At the end of Batman vs. Superman, we can see that Wonder Woman has a sort of loss of faith in humanity. Is she going to find it back after the event of Zack Snyder's Justice League? And if there's going to be a specific member of the League that will help her find it back? Also wanted to know if there's going to be any mention of another female member of the League. Thank you. Bye.
Well, first of all, I won't say anything about if there's any additional female members of the League, because that feels like a pretty huge spoiler, even if there... you know,
you mean you
either
just gonna
way,
give it away 2 weeks
no,
before the movie comes out?
And then as far as Diana's arc, I think that, like, you know, it's, for me, it's coming straight off of BVS, right? And if you recall, you know, the yes, she had sort of lost faith in humanity, but I feel like had awoken a little bit to her responsibilities in the world without Superman. And I, that's kind of where she is, you know. She's not, I wouldn't say, you know, I think when her mom sends her note via the arrow of Artemis, she, I think that she realizes that, like, there's a, what's happening is a pretty big deal. So, you know, I don't know that she's fully out, but she's definitely, you know, she's fighting for the team at this point.
Now, of course, there are some new heroes we're getting to see in this movie. And this question is from a huge fan who goes by the name of Harry L. So let's take a look at his question.
Zack Snyder, Harry Lennox here. Huge fan. But I have a question for you. Kelvin Swanwick, who was the CENTCOM commander there, the general, and then later became Secretary of Defense, was all along he really Martian Manhunter pretending to be Kelvin Swanwick? Or is he just pretending to be Kelvin Swanwick in this moment of the Justice League, since he also pretends to be Martha Kent, according to the storyboards that you release? Has he been this man in hiding all along? I'm very curious. Please let me know.
He's quite a fan, that guy.
I heard he really loves the movies.
Yeah, I feel like he really loves them. So much so that, you know, he might, like, walk in front of the camera. A couple times.
It's a good question, yeah, though. I'm curious.
It's a great question. In my mind, I think he's been Swanwick and Martian Manhunter are kind of it's like his alter ego. That's kind of the way I see it. And the way he's kind of, if you notice the way he's kind of, like, he's manipulated both Lois and Clark to kind of do their best, you know, to be the best they can be, because I think, you know, in this incarnation, he wants humanity to kind of do it themselves, and or this new hero in Superman. And I think that's kind of the way I see it, that he's, you know, they have the same voice.
I can't wait to see, by the way, what you have cooked up for Martian Manhunter. Really excited to see the new live action depiction of that. But I wanted to talk about Cyborg as well, because, you know, as we were talking about, you've said Ray Fisher's character is the heart of your movie, but we've since found out that, you know, the planned continuation of Cyborg's story with him continuing in a Flash movie won't be happening. So I'm curious how you feel your movie serves as essentially a standalone look at that character's arc.
Yeah, well, I guess, you know, when we were talking about making the movie, I really, you know, Chris Terrio and I really, like, we really gravitated towards Cyborg as this, you know, as really, like, as I've said a thousand times, like, the heart of the movie, sort of the linchpin, everything turns on him, everything turns on kind of his, the stakes that are presented to him, the events that befall him within the context of the film. So, yeah, it was always my intention to, like, really use Cyborg as the, well, you know, sort of the glue that sticks the movie together. And then, but never really, I never saw this as, you know, what would be a standalone film as far as, like, Cyborg's story. I think there's plenty of story left for Cyborg, of course. He's an amazing character, and it's great to see, you know, him really realize that on the movie. When you see it, you're gonna realize that, you know, Cyborg is tip of the iceberg, in my opinion. So, you know, who knows? We're here now. So,
this is another great question from Siddhi Vinayak Sridhar from India, who asked this question on YouTube.
I am Siddhi Vinayak from India, and my question is, why was Joker included in the Justice League Snyder Cut version when he was not part of the script in 2017? And thanks, IGN, for giving me this opportunity. Love from India.
But I think that it's a good question, but it really is all about just trying to fulfill the promise of having a Joker in this universe and not having them come together. And also, there was a question I had, you know, always wanted him to be in the nightmare reality. And so it was a great opportunity. And when I talked to Jared and he was interested in doing it, I just felt like, okay, this feels like a thing I can't pass up.
Now, of course, when you start showing looks at the Joker, people have a lot of questions because we've seen so many different versions of how visually he is portrayed in live action. So this question comes from All Things Zack Snyder, aka Yaniv from Israel on Twitter. They wanted to know what inspired the new Joker look and whether you consulted with David Ayer at all about when you kind of re-envisioned that look that he created in Suicide Squad.
So what inspired the look was, you know, the sort of post-apocalyptic world that I'm a huge fan of, and really the idea was that as the movies progressed, the next movie, if there ever was one, and doesn't seem like there ever will be, but if there was, it would exist primarily in that world with them trying to set it right. We played around with a lot of different things. I did a bunch of drawings. We pulled a bunch of different costumes and tried a bunch of different looks. Jared had a bunch of great ideas, and we all kind of mashed that together and sort of settled on this cool version of Joker. Now, as far as David goes, I did not consult with him, but I did look at all of the reference and all the like vast photo, you know, as well as the movie, but all these other depictions that they had in print and in advertising and stuff like that. And a lot of it was, I was inspired a lot by that imagery.
We still have more questions about the villains, but I did want to follow up on one thing you mentioned there about, you know, your original plan for Justice League Part 2, because originally when this was announced in the whole slate back, you know, in the early 2010s, there was the plan for Justice League first part and then a second part to come later. Now, obviously you have four hours of Zack Snyder's Justice League, but I'm curious how much of that, if any, does encompass your plans for Part 2?
Well, it was meant to be two more movies. Nope, it doesn't really encompass any of the additional movies other than little, I mean, it hints as you would at a potential other world, you know, like when you, you know, like I plant the seeds as I had wanted to of what would come in the, you know, later films. So, that's in there, but as far as those stories, yeah, no, that would be yet to come if ever that happened, which it does not look like it would, but I think it's easy to speculate based on that. And we can talk about that for quite a while.
Yeah. So there was no plan for this to be like a cliffhanger ending then that picked up in a later film? Was it designed?
Or no, it was. It is a cliffhanger.
Zack.
The movie ends in a massive cliffhanger. Yeah.
Well, you know what's going to happen after that. I mean, you know, we'll talk about that. We'll talk about that in a little bit. We definitely have questions about a part two coming up. But I did want to ask, you know, you have Deathstroke in this movie. We know you have Joe Manganiello coming back as Deathstroke. Yeah. So I wanted to ask a similar question to the Joker one. Why was it important for you to include Joe Manganiello's Deathstroke in this movie? And how will it be different than what we've seen in the past?
Well, Joe's character in this movie, when we find him, clearly he and Batman have struck some sort of a deal, and they're in, you know, they have a bit of a partnership. You know, there's a bigger enemy, I guess. So, I think that's the big difference. They're not locked in mortal combat. They're actually kind of working together to try and figure out how to make this world work.
No. Yeah, he was another great example of fantastic casting that I think we've all just been itching to see a little bit more of. So excited to see it here. Now, I do have another question. Of course, we can't talk about Zack Snyder's Justice League without talking about the big bad himself, Darkseid. So this question comes from Federico Berto on Twitter. We have a video.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Zack. I have a question about Darkseid. So your characters are always complex and layered. Does Darkseid have any humanly relatable motivation to his quest other than that of ruling all of existence? Well, thanks for everything, Zack, and I'll see you on the 18th. Bye-bye.
Yeah, no, of course. I think, of course, Darkseid has human motivation. I don't know if you would call it that. He's pretty, he kind of operates on another plane. But certainly, something happened to him in the past and he's not happy about it. And it's kind of really hurt him. It's kind of shaped him. And he's looking to make it right. And so I think that there's a lot of nuance in him. And, Ray does a great job of voicing him. He's really great.
Now, you can probably guess what this question will be about based on the name of the person who submitted it. This is from Steppenwolf on Twitter. Let's pull up the video for that.
Hello, Zack. I had one question about Steppenwolf from your cut. Here it is. How would you describe the relationship between him and Darkseid? Is there something more than Steppenwolf's desire to get rid of his control?
It's a good question. I would say that the thing that's interesting, I think, is that for sure the Steppenwolf-Darkseid relationship is very complicated. I'm not going to give it away, but there's a very, the dynamic between the two of them. Some things happened in the past. There's a bunch of issues between them. And so, yeah, I think that all plays out. So, yes, the answer is there's quite a complex relationship there.
We do have a question from Jean-Ren Durand, a Twitter video that we can pull up here. I'm assuming that he's powered by HBO Max in setting up the offer he's putting, but let's take a look.
Mr. Zack Snyder, my question for you is, if HBO Max offered you money to do Justice League 2, what would you say? Thank you.
Well, that's a very hypothetical. I think that I would say I would believe it when I see it, and happy to cross that bridge when I see it approaching. So, but thank you for the question. But yeah, I think we should enjoy the movie we have. But yes, that's my answer.
Now, this question came up quite a bit. I picked one from Zack Snyder Mania on Twitter. It seemed appropriate. A lot of people were curious if we'd ever get an answer to who was in the empty pod from Man of Steel, or if that was something that you crash. Felt was like... Sorry, what?
The open crash, yeah. You see it again in Justice League. You know, they pass it again. I don't know. I've never seen.
So probably no surprise that people have brought it up multiple
this
times.
This is a famous thing that I've never seen the theatrical version of Justice League. So I'm not sure if the open crash is in the theatrical version, but it definitely is in Justice League. They pass it and they look at it and they don't talk about it. But yeah, so that is an open question, and I would hope at some point to find out who was in there, like what's going on.
Do you know?
I do now. I do.
All right. Mm-hmm. Listen, there's going to be a release the open pod answer hashtag at a certain point.
There already is. Trust me. That one's not. You're not getting that one. Not for a while anyway. Or ever.
Now, I do. I was telling you a little bit before we started recording. I am so intrigued about the nightmare sequence. That was one of my favorite things that you set up in BVS, and I'm really excited that we're clearly going to see a good deal more of it here. I was wondering if you could talk about how big that section is of Justice League, because some people have been speculating, like, could that even be an entire chapter, or is it going to be a relatively minimal?
No.
Not a full
it's
chapter.
Relatively minimal, but it's definitely the length. I think it's appropriate for the movie. It's not anything crazy, but it definitely, like, doesn't overstay its welcome, but it definitely does what I needed it to do for the story and for us. Beyond that, I think it's a spoiler, so I'm gonna
I can't wait. And honestly, I'm really intrigued that, you know, that was your original setting for Justice League 2, earlier.
Yeah.
Whole nightmare movie.
Yeah, nightmare movie.
We're so close to the release of the movie, and you've been amazing in the past about releasing, you know, different versions, IMAX versions of your films, the extended editions and ultimate editions. So unsurprisingly got a lot of questions about kind of your release plans and potential multiple release plans. So with that context, first I wanted to ask, you know, you've been releasing a good amount of promotional material in black and white, and we were curious, are there any plans to release both a color and black and white version to HBO Max, or can you speak about if there will be multiple versions uploaded to HBO Max?
Yes, there is a what we call the Justice is Gray edition of Justice League. Zack Snyder's Justice League Justice is Gray edition, which is the black and white version, which I'm a huge advocate of and a huge admirer of. It's personally for me, it's my favorite version of the movie. I understand that people want to see it in color, and that's great, and I really want them to enjoy it in color, but for me, the ultimate version is the black and white IMAX version of the movie, which is sort of the penultimate ridiculous movie that shouldn't exist at its highest, most fetishistic level, and I really love that.
Are you planning to release both of them as well?
Yes, sorry. And of course, the black and white version of Justice League will be released on HBO Max at some point after release, I believe. And you'll be able to see that somehow on I don't know how you're going to get to it, but that's the plan. And then the as far as IMAX go, you know, as we start to figure out how people can get back in the movie theaters and see movies at any point, I would hope for an opportunity to let fans get in the theater and see the color and black and white versions of Justice League on the big screen, with a beautiful intermission, chunky XL intermission, like amazing suite. It's an afternoon and into evening experience. It's pretty cool.
It's literally the length of a double feature. Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah. That's so exciting. And what an amazing way to celebrate being able to go back to theater safely as well. The idea.
Yeah, I would love that to come to pass. That's my hope for everybody, but we'll see. You know, I'm still waiting to see how that would play out.
Yeah. Now, you have been such a great fan of IMAX and friend to IMAX your entire career. I believe you said you actually shot this movie entirely in IMAX, either in IMAX cameras or
in the format. Now, I didn't use the IMAX cameras per se because their cameras aren't sound. And I knew there was only going to be a lot of dialogue in this movie. So, but I did shoot it in the aspect ratio that would be ideal for the big 1/4:3 theaters. And so when you see it in its big, you know, square, it's unbelievable because, you know, they've never done a movie in IMAX that's entirely in that aspect ratio, and they've never done one in black and white, so it's kind of two firsts in a row, so it's kind of fun to see.
Yeah, amazing. I'm really excited to see the ratio that you, I know you said that you've been working really hard to restore that as well, get those full shots rebuilt. So I can't wait to see that.
Yeah, we shot the whole movie, you know, in that aspect ratio. It was my, you know, the compromise was when I told the studio I shot it in 1/4:3 or in 1/3:3 actually is what the aspect ratio I shot it in. They were like, no, you can't do that. And I was like, well, you know, so we did do a crop. Initially, I wanted to do a 1/6:6 crop for normal theaters, and then you would see it in 1/4:3 or 1/3:3 or 1/4:3 at the in IMAX. But the glory of the one glorious thing about the HBO Max release is you get to see it in the true format that it was intended, which you know would have been difficult, you know, otherwise.
Yeah. Now, obviously, this is making a massive debut on HBO Max, but you have a lot of collectors in your fans, of course. And again, you've released special versions of Blu-rays and stuff in the past. So people were wondering if you know if there will eventually be a physical release of this cut on Blu-ray or a 4K version or Dolby Vision or any of these kind of special version releases.
Yeah, you know what? I don't know at this point. I know we've talked about it, but I just don't know. I can't say exactly, but I would love that. I mean, I think that would be a great evolution for people to be able to have a hard copy, you know, at home. But yeah, you know, I don't know.
And you know, I will say, looking back at the journey this film has made, what fans have accomplished in the rallying cry for releasing the Snyder Cut is simply unprecedented within our pop culture sphere and Hollywood sphere. So I'm curious, how does, you know, the voice that fans have had in allowing this movie to be released, how do you see that changing Hollywood or the way movies are made going forward, if at all?
Yeah, I don't know. I will say that, you know, this is a slightly unique circumstance. But I think what it does tell us is that, you know, you could trust the fans, you know, you can trust the audience to, you know, have good taste and have and be smart and want what they want. And I think that's an important thing. It's an important lesson. And also just the amazing work they've done, you know, for using this movie as a rallying cry to raise money for suicide awareness, prevention awareness. And, just the life-saving work these fans have done is you can't talk about it enough.
Yeah, more than $500,000 raised for suicide prevention is pretty incredible. Yeah. And to use this movie
pretty incredible
for that purpose. Yeah. Now, of course, I always feel terrible asking questions like these because we're talking about a movie that's taken so long to come out, and yet I'm going to talk to you about the future, about what's next. Now, you do have another movie on the horizon, your first movie that you've filmed since making Justice League, which is Army of the Dead,
yep,
coming to Netflix soon.
Yep.
And a teaser just came out. We finally got at least a taste of what this movie will look like. Now, I'm a huge fan of your Dawn of the Dead. I adore it. I think it's hilarious and did such a fun job playing with all these different tropes. Here with Army of the Dead, you're playing with two very popular genres and mashing them together. You're taking the heist genre and you're taking the zombie genre and saying, what if we made a heist zombie movie? And I know this was an old pitch that you had that you brought back to Netflix as well to see. And they were like, oh yeah, of course, make this movie. This makes so much sense. So I'm curious, what can you tell us about this? I know I just gave you a huge setup, but what can you tell us?
No. Yeah, I really wanted to make a movie. I thought of this a while ago. I really wanted to make this super genre, self-aware kind of romp. I didn't, you know, we have this whole, there's been this huge renaissance of this huge sort of hunger for heist movies. And when I thought of this, like, you know, a while ago, it wasn't even at the fever pitch that it is now. So it's been an incredible, it's been a fun seeing this movie evolve into what it has. But yeah, it sends a love letter to some of my favorite films, Escape from New York, Aliens, you know, to name a few, pretty much all the zombie films. But yeah, really, really fun.
And you are making it a franchise too. In your there's the animated series as well that's coming to Netflix that I believe is a prequel.
Yes,
the
animated series, and then we also just shot a prequel in Europe, in sort of a German and French language and English language prequel with Dieter's character, who's the safecracker.
Now, is this in universe with your Dawn of the Dead? Is that how you're envisioning it,
or no,
is that?
It's not. No, it's not. It's not in universe. It's a completely its own thing, playing with the tropes and or self-awareness of a film. You know, I find that really, you know, to deconstruct the movie from the beginning is really fun. You know?
Yeah, and what an embarrassment of riches for us as well to have you coming back with two very exciting films on the horizon. I'm very excited. I'm at long last to see the your version of Justice League as well as Army of the Dead. I am curious. I mean, this is IGN Fan Fest. I know I've brought you so many fan questions already, but I didn't know if you had anything that you wanted to say to fans on the relative eve of your Snyder Cut coming out.
Well, only that, you know, how grateful I am for the support that I feel every day from the fans and the incredible outcry and outpouring of support our charity and for, you know, the just me as a creator. So I couldn't ask for more, you know, from a fan community, and I really thank him from the bottom of my heart.
Well, Zack, you have been so generous with your time. Thank you so much for chatting with us today. Zack Snyder's Justice League is coming to HBO Max on March 18th, so you'll see it very soon. Zack, thank you so much.
Awesome, you guys. Thank you so much. You've been amazing. Thank you.